probabilities can easily trip us up. A diagnostic test that seemed extremely accurate can have a very low predictive power. And misunderstanding probabilities in trial testimony has led to innocent people being convicted of terrible crimes. Bayes' rule is a simple but incredibly powerful way for us to update probabilities based on new evidence and fix our often very wrong intuition. Let's explore Bayes' rule in 5 levels, ranging from medical testing and trial testimony to the entire branch of statistics that's built from the power of Bayes' rule. For level 1, let's look at medical testing for a disease. Say 1% of a population has this disease and a screening test is available. Out of those with the disease, the test is positive, indicating the disease 95% of the time, and it gives a false negative the other 5% of the time. This is a conditional probability. The probability someone tests positive given that they have the disease is 95%. For those without the disease, the probability of testing positive is 3%, and the probability of testing negative is 97%. This seems like a pretty accurate test. So the test is administered to a randomly selected individual from the population, and the test is positive. It says the person has the disease. What's the probability this individual really does have the disease? This probability tree illustrates these events. We can find the probabilities for each of the 4 groups by multiplying the values along the branches. For example, 1% of individuals have the disease, and out of those, 95% will have a positive test result. This is the probability of having the disease times the conditional probability of testing positive given having the disease. This probability is 0.0095 or 0.95%. So just under 1% of all individuals fall into this group, having the disease and a positive test result. But the test can also be a false positive. 99% of individuals do not have the disease, and 3% of those will have a positive test result. That's 2.97% of people who will have a false positive. If a randomly selected person tests positive for the disease, they're in one of these 2 branches. So the conditional probability of having the disease is 0.0095 divided by the sum of 0.0095 and 0.0297. That's about 24%. Even though this test seemed very accurate, since the disease is fairly rare in the population and the person was selected randomly, a positive test is most likely a false positive, and there's only about a 24% chance that the person really has the disease. This method of calculation is called Bayes' rule, and it's a powerful way for us to update our beliefs based on new evidence. For level 2, let's see how Bayes' theorem applies to criminal justice. Last night, there was a hit and run involving a taxi. In that city, 85% of the taxis are green and 15% are blue. An eyewitness says the taxi was blue. However, the witness was tested to see how often they correctly identified blue and green at night, and they were correct only 80% of the time. Given the eyewitness testimony, what's the probability that the taxi involved was blue? This is Kahneman's taxicab problem. A tempting answer might be 80%, since the eyewitness correctly identifies the colors at night 80% of the time. But this is the wrong probability. The probability the witness says the taxi was blue, given the taxi really was blue, is 80%. But as a member of a jury, we would have to decide the probability the taxi really was blue, given that the witness says it was blue. Reversing those events can completely change the probabilities. Let's draw a probability tree to visualize this. 85% of the taxis are green and 15% are blue. If the taxi is green, the witness has an 80% chance of saying the taxi was green, and the other 20% of the time, the taxi will be misidentified as blue. If the taxi really is blue, then the witness has an 80% chance of saying the taxi was blue, and the other 20% of the time, the witness misidentifies the taxi as being green. Since the witness says the taxi was blue, we must be in one of these 2 branches. Now we apply Bayes' rule to find the probability the taxi really is blue, given the witness says it was blue. That's the ratio of this branch's probability to the sum of the 2 branches' probabilities. there's only about a 41.4% chance the taxi really was blue. Since there are many more green taxis in the city than blue, it's actually more likely that the taxi was green and the witness misidentified the colors. That's not to say the witness's testimony is meaningless. It increases our prior probability of only 15% to about 41.4%. This is a significant increase in the likelihood of the taxi being blue, but it's nowhere near being 80% likely. We'll need more evidence than just this one witness testimony in order to have any real certainty about the taxi's color. For level 3, let's prove Bayes' theorem, utilizing pictures to illustrate the calculations. We have two events A and B contained in a sample space, the set of all possible outcomes. We can use a Venn diagram to illustrate the events. Now let's find the conditional probability of A given B. Since we're told B is true, we restrict our attention to just the event B. This is like our updated sample space. We know B happened, so we must be inside this event. In this new perspective, the only way A can happen is if we're in the overlap between A and B. So the updated probability of A is the ratio of that overlap to the circle for B. Symbolically, the probability of A given B is the probability of the intersection of A and B, the probability they both happen, divided by the probability of B. Now, if we multiply this conditional probability by the probability of B, we'll cancel the denominator and end up with just the probability of the intersection of A and B. This is called the multiplication rule for conditional probabilities. Now we're almost there. We can use the same reasoning to show the probability of B given A times the probability of A equals the probability of A and B. So these two products are equal. And then we can divide the probability of B to the other side to get Bayes' rule. Bayes' rule is a powerful tool to fix our mistaken intuitions and improve our critical thinking. A free and easy way to explore Bayes' rule and probability and statistics is with Brilliant, the sponsor of this video. With Brilliant, you learn by doing, exploring thousands of interactive lessons in math, data analysis, programming, and AI. Brilliant helps you build your understanding from the ground up, solving problems and interacting with new ideas. For example, instead of just reading about joint probabilities, you engage with the idea, filtering data to discover the joint distribution. With Brilliant, you learn through problem solving, not memorizing. Crafted by teachers and professionals from MIT, Caltech, Google, and more, Brilliant helps you build your knowledge in a few spare minutes each day. In Brilliant's course, How Large Language Models Work, you interact with several LLMs. One of them is trained on terms and conditions documents, and another is trained on Taylor Swift lyrics. By exploring these models, you learn the importance of the training data in creating an LLM. You'll explore how the model generates its next word and how the temperature setting influences the result. You'll see how a model can be fine-tuned to generate specific kinds of output, like poetry or Python scripts. To try everything Brilliant has to offer for free for a full 30 days, visit brilliant.org/drshawn or click on the link in the description. You'll also get 20% off an annual premium subscription. For level 4, let's see how Bayes' theorem works for continuous random variables. Continuous random variables have uncountably many possible values. Usually, they can be any real number within some interval. The probability a continuous random variable exactly equals any one number is 0. Instead, we have a density function that we integrate to find probabilities. This allows us to work with uncountably many possible values and still have our probabilities between 0 and 1. Let's say x is an exponential random variable with rate 1. This means its density function is f of x equals e to the negative x for x greater than or equal to 0. Then let's use this value as the rate for an exponential random variable y. So the conditional density function for y given x equals x is xe to the negative xy for y greater than or equal to 0. The distribution of y depends on the value of x, and we know exactly the formula for this conditional distribution. But what if we observe the value of y, but we don't know the value of x? We can apply Bayes' rule to reverse the conditioning. This works essentially the same way as before, but we need to use density functions. Bayes' rule tells us that the density of x given y is equal to the density of y given x times the density of x divided by the density of y. We already know two of the three parts on the right-hand side, so we just need to find the density of y by itself. To start, let's find the joint density function for x and y. We get this by multiplying the density function of y given x by the density of x. This is just like how the probability of A and B is the product of the probability of B given A times the probability of A. Now that we have the joint density function, we can integrate the x variable out, leaving just the y variable. This will give us the marginal distribution of y by itself. We integrate from x equals 0 to infinity. We can use integration by parts to find that the integral is 1 over y plus 1 squared. This is the missing piece we needed. Plugging this back into Bayes' rule, we find the conditional density of x given y, which simplifies to x y plus 1 squared times e to the negative x y plus 1. Here, both x and y are non-negative. Reversing the order of conditioning like this is critical for Bayesian statistics, which we'll get to next. For level 5, let's see how Bayes' theorem allows us to make statistical inferences. Say we have a biased coin that comes up heads with probability p and tails with probability 1 minus p. We flip the coin 5 times to help determine the value of p. If we get tails all 5 times, what should be our estimate of p given our sample? One option is to say that 0 out of the 5 flips were heads, so we'll just estimate p equals 0, meaning there's a probability 0 that the coin comes up heads. But this is pretty extreme. It's possible that we just didn't flip the coin enough times to see it come up heads. So instead, we can do Bayesian inference. Initially, we have no information about p other than we know it's a probability between 0 and 1. So we could model p as a uniform random variable between 0 and 1. That has a constant density function 1 on the interval from 0 to 1. Given the value of p, we can find the probability that we get a specific sequence of heads and tails in the first 5 flips. Each heads has probability p, and each tails has probability 1 minus p. Let's encode each flip as a 1 for heads and a 0 for tails. For the ith flip, we'll call this encoded value xi. Then we can write these probabilities as this product. Whenever xi equals 1, this represents heads, and the quantity simplifies to p. And similarly for tails, xi equals 0, and the quantity simplifies to 1 minus p. Since the flips are independent, we get the probability of the entire sequence by multiplying the individual probabilities together. Let's say we have k total heads and 5 minus k tails. Then we'll get this simplification. This is the distribution of x given p. Our goal is to find the distribution of p given x, so we use Bayes' theorem. We take the density of p, multiply by f of x given p, and then we need to divide by the marginal distribution of x. To find this, we integrate the variable p out of the joint distribution so that only x remains. That's the integral from 0 to 1 of p to the k times 1 minus p to the 5 minus k dp. This is just a normalizing constant, so it's not too important what that constant is. It just makes sure our density function integrates to 1. So we see the updated density for p, the posterior distribution, is proportional to p to the k 1 minus p to the 5 minus k. This is a type of beta distribution. In our case, k equals 0 since we got 5 tails in a row. The density will be proportional to 1 minus p to the 5th. In this particular case, the normalizing constant is quite nice. It's just 1/6. So our density function is 6 times 1 minus p to the 5th. Graphing this, we see that p is likely to be closer to 0 and farther from 1 as we'd expect. If we find the expected value of the posterior distribution, we get 1/7. So if we had to make a specific guess for the value of p, we can guess p equals 1/7. This is a more reasonable estimator than just saying p equals 0. And if we continue to flip the coin in the future, we can keep updating the distribution of p to get a more and more accurate understanding of what the value of p really is. This is the power of Bayesian statistics. What's your favorite application of Bayes' theorem? Let us know in the comments. Thanks so much for watching, and I'll see you next time.